Hello and welcome. It's time for us to have another interesting conversation. And in the studio with us today, we have a very interesting gentleman. Someone with over 21 years advertising experience. Someone who's evolved from a strategist to a multi-market business development specialist. Someone with proven abilities in standardization of output, where standards vary across different markets. He's lived and worked in four markets in Africa over the past 10 years, Nigeria, South Africa, Kenya, and Ghana. And in the course of his career, has visited 35 of Africa's 53 countries. I'm talking about the one and only country manager of JCDecaux, Mr. Dele Odugbemi. Welcome to the studio.
Thank you so much.
It's great to have you here.
Glad to be here.
A lot of years under your belt, a lot of notches in your belt, I should say.
I'll try not to hold.
Okay. That wasn't the intention. That wasn't the intention.
Thank you.
The intention was to learn and gather as much knowledge as possible from someone like you. It's all about how advertising has evolved over the years. Strategy, advertising, the West African dynamic.
Yes.
It can't have been an easy journey for you, especially in this kind of climate. So let's talk about how it all began. Please let us in to your little world.
Okay. Thank you.
It's a huge world, actually.
I think it's little. The world is big. So whatever part we have to play in it, surely has to be little. So thanks again for having me. It's a pleasure to be here to share knowledge and kind of interact and get to speak about something I'm very passionate about, which is advertising. Mm. And then the other thing which I'm passionate about, which is the African continent. So it's quite an interesting combination. So advertising over the last 21 years is one business that's evolved. And I know every business says that because, you know, even for the oil industry, they are impacted by the climate change movement and, you know, all of that. So every industry has needed to move in some direction and find some level of progress. But when we say advertising is kind of changed, what we're talking about really is it's been impacted a lot by technology. So the change was forced onto it. At the time when we were growing up and we had what was called media channels, they were pretty much channels that you engage by appointment. You, on your way to school, you would have a radio in your dad's car. You listen to some form of news or whatever music that is being played. That was the medium you got exposed to at the time. When you go home after school, you got to see a bit of TV, family time, you know, all of the soap operas and all of that. So it was pretty much more by appointment, time to watch something.
Sure.
Now, what then later happened is technology democratized that, if you will, and made media content relatively available to people across the world. And therefore, I no longer get impacted by the content of just my own environment. I get easy access to content that's come out of other places. So technology kind of has impacted advertising in such a way that it's caused such a dramatic shift that I don't actually recognize the profession anymore versus when I started.
Wow.
But also you could say that for the African continent, because, you know, at the time when I started, it was when Africa was going through this renaissance of sorts, almost like people were rediscovering Africa all over again because the former military governments were becoming more democratic. And Africa was being given a chance. Mm. So there were lots of global companies that came into Africa at the time, brought their standards and demanded that, you know, people who were practicing advertising try to match global standards. Mm. And then you have today where you have some African advertising that win global awards.
Fantastic.
That probably wouldn't have been something that you'd have had 20 years ago.
Mm.
So yeah, technology's changed a lot. Continent has moved forward. It's a very interesting dynamic that we now have. So, yeah.
So you've been able to work in different areas, four different markets, all in Africa.
Yes.
Now, I've had the opportunity to work hand in hand with a few advertising agencies in Nigeria, but I've never really had the opportunity to compare markets. So what is it that you believe really drives each market? I know that they're completely different factors that drive it, but the people are a main tangent. So give us some insight.
Okay. Actually, we'll start with the word you use, insight.
Okay.
The key difference is the insight for every market is different.
Okay.
So I'm lucky to have had a West East South experience, so I can speak to about East African market, speak to about South African market, and certainly about West Africa, which is where I'm from. Yeah. I have had exposure to North Africa, but I haven't lived there, but I've run campaigns there, so I can speak about, you know, what their own dynamics are. And again, to reiterate, the key issue is insight. So you find Southern Africa that's got a lot of, in its post-colonial existence, you don't have independence in the way, maybe like the sense we get in West and East, where what happened with Zimbabwe, for example, was a war that then kind of led to an evolution into a government of the day, which pretty meant people who were in Zimbabwe pre-independence stayed in Zimbabwe post-independence, versus in Nigeria where we would say the British left. So a lot of that you find across Southern Africa, where it's pretty much the nation development was of people who were there. So the transition was not therefore major. I mean, you had the political situation in South Africa with apartheid, but pretty much everywhere else, what's happened is therefore their own situation is multiracial.
Amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. So because it is multiracial, so then standardization of advertising about insight then gets tricky. Because what is an insight about, say, the black African is not necessarily the insight of the white African, whose circumstance in Africa is a bit different. So that dynamic was quite interesting to be a part of it, to see, you know, whatever we would want to say are, say, differences. The more we call them differences and the more we interrogated them, the more we actually found that they were the same. It was just interpretation on different sides. Which is based on your own culture or bringing what you're used to. So you interpret this as something, another person interprets it as something else. But our humanity is all the same. So that was quite interesting. West Africa is more homogeneous. The Fulani tribe, the Yoruba tribe, the Igbo tribe, the, you know, all of the tribes in West Africa makes, as you travel West Africa, you find the food is a bit similar. There's always the debate about the jollof rice and all that. So there is a lot more homogeneous.
There's a lot more to work with.
There's a lot more to work with. Now, what that means for brands is that it's not too much of a risk if you attempted a West African campaign, because the nuances are not that far off. Their own post-independence experience is whoever they were subjugated to left, and they were left to create a new nation. That's their dynamic, completely different from the Southern African one. And East Africa is a bit similar to West Africa in the post-colonial markets, were one where it was more like recreate the nation, you know. And that why I wanted to emphasize that is, I think it's in terms of what is brought, why East Africa is different from West Africa and certainly different from Southern Africa, is that background definitely translates into access to education, translates into ability to grapple things. And what does that mean for advertising? It means when you're campaigning in East Africa, you need that nuance. You need that background.
But what about earning capabilities of the different sectors? So I do believe that in West Africa, we have a lot of higher earners. So I don't know if this is completely true, even as at now. I'm not sure the statistics exactly, but we have a lot of higher earners in West Africa. So if, for instance, you were pushing a campaign to both East, West, and, well, maybe all of the sectors at the same time, would you consider making some look a little more classy than others?
Upmarket.
That's the word I'm looking for.
I'm not sure that you could make that blanket statement across the continent.
Okay.
I think the access to funds, again, maybe access to education, you know, kind of influence the number, the sheer number of people. And let's remember, West Africa is heavily populated, championed by Nigeria, that's already like 200 million. So if you have 50% of Nigerians educated, that's 100 million people. Okay. If you said 50% of Malawians were educated, that's about 6 million people.
Oh, wow.
So that is almost an unfair. So that what why it would seem like we have a lot of high income earners is the percentage relative to the population. So that there is just a sheer number around here. That is it. But as a percentage of population, the what we would call the upper class, the AB socioeconomic class, is typically about 5%.
Wow. Okay.
So that 5% will be 5% representative of West Africa, 5% representative of East Africa, which I mean the population will be a factor.
So it does really depend on the brand that is being pushed out.
Yes.
So
yes.
For instance, if I was pushing a brand new Lexus, you know, a brand new Mercedes, I understand that 5% is my core market.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And in the world before now, you would have a lot of wastage about how you were trying to reach that audience.
Okay.
Because again, the channels were by appointment.
Hmm.
So you kind of needed to show up at home and then 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, the news then runs.
True.
And then the ad runs, right?
Sure.
But now the ad can target you because you are an IP address.
Okay.
Versus you are a mass audience. So I think that's the major different technology has brought. You have the opportunity to engage an audience real time in their area of location, wherever they're located, with a specific message. Just picture whatever was mass, so whatever was mass, you couldn't address individuals. But now that it's targeted, you could be, they could say, Titi,
yeah,
click this. It's that straightforward because you're an IP address.
Yeah.
So that the dynamic that we now face where there is a lot of efficiencies in how we have campaigns now to clients' joy because they're not wasting their money. So that's been a good progress.
So it does seem challenging for the traditional advertising agency, one who hasn't, so to speak, evolved as much as some others. So, for instance, it does feel like the traditional advertising agency could eventually become obsolete, because of the fact that the actual clients themselves are more inclined to making some of these things work in-house.
Mm-hmm. The word there is accountability. There is a lot of how advertising is looked at that is more the art form. Playful.
Mm.
The commercials are funny. Then you look at production. Maybe the lifestyle of the people who do it, and you think, like, these are creative minds. Mm. They're probably freewheeling and so on. Whereas it is a business, it is something that has a lot more science to it than something I think is brought to the table, because that advertising, the creative that we all laugh at, there's a lot of insight that goes into why they decided to go with that storytelling, if you like.
Okay, sure.
And then having gone that route with the storytelling, then you could decide, these are the channels that will impact the audience, blah, blah, blah. Long story short, when a client puts, say, $100 million into a campaign, what the client wants to know is that $100 million got the impact that was desired, the campaign objective, as it's called.
Okay.
So for a long time, the measurement technique was very difficult, because what you're doing is you're trying to extrapolate for a mass audience using a sample size.
Hmm.
So you would say for gross rating point, you would say, this is the kind of like the demographics. And therefore, let's say like 18 to 35, blah, blah, blah.
Mm.
Then for Nigeria, let's take 20,000 representation of that.
Okay.
And let's examine how they consume media.
Mm.
On that basis, let's make a media recommendation.
Mm.
On that basis, the client then pays,
okay.
Right? Now, today's world, I don't have to take that sample size. Everyone is measured. Everyone, you're an IP address.
Yeah.
Everyone. So if I'm running a campaign that is digital, I could tell the client that of the 100,000 target audience that they had, maybe 50,000 engaged the campaign. And that would be accurate. But when it was mass, we had taken a sample to extrapolate. So there was a question mark as to the level of the accuracy of that.
It was an approximation.
Approximation.
Okay.
So it's that accountability that has gotten better.
Mm.
That I think the agencies just need to embrace.
Mm.
I don't always look at it like if there's a new way of doing things, that means the people who were doing other things prior will go extinct. I don't think life goes that way.
Okay.
I think people can unlearn what they've learned before.
Okay.
But it's just to accept the clients want more accountability. That's the shift. Every market has changed. There's always something that shifts it. The shift is accountability. That is, I'm spending $100 million.
Yeah.
I want more bang for the buck. I want more impact for it. Just show me how you've done it. So that maybe tomorrow, learning from how we did it yesterday, we could change some things. So if you're accountable, the more accountable you are, the more of value you add to the client. That's just the shift.
So I guess that's where testing comes in. Testing with sample sizes, but then you have more better analytics.
Absolutely.
As opposed to what we had before.
Absolutely.
But then it does feel heavily reliant on certain platforms, such as Google, Facebook, and other data companies.
Let's say digital platforms.
Digital platforms now.
Yeah.
So it does feel heavily reliant on that. When was it Facebook and Instagram shut down for a few hours? We heard
panic.
How much panic people went through. This is not just people in their homes. Now, this is companies who have pending campaigns that were supposed to run, targets, etc.
Yeah.
Doesn't it feel like the way technology is going, we have completely let go of control? Okay, so it gives you more control in a sense, but you've let go of the control to essentially foreign companies who are managing this for you. So in our space, are there companies who could do this for us better?
Okay, so I think you've treated two issues there. There's first the fact that digital is more dominant in the area of accountability.
Sure.
And digital, maybe rather than look at it like it was the future, is actually more the present now. I think that's the number one issue.
Yes, yes.
And the second is that the players are mostly global.
Exactly.
Doesn't that impact on, say, local media owners and all of that? And
what's stopping us from having our own?
Nothing, because China has got its own. Remember, all that's happened is those guys have created a community. That's all that it is. That's all that it is. It's a community, right? So a platform is there. If you're not on Facebook, you can't be impacted by it. It's really that simple. So a community can happen in Nigeria tomorrow. It can. It's just, again, you have to be more deliberate about it and all that. So, for example, Guinness at some point did the VIP that they put as online, kind of like a collation of fans of football.
Yeah.
And that was managed in that direction. It's not that difficult to put communities together. It's how do you engage them? And then do you then have the tools that keep them going? What's the Facebook addiction? Keep them coming back. What's the Facebook addiction? Basically, it's not a media company. It's a platform.
Yeah.
So, picture of the food I ate this morning. To let my friends know.
Yeah.
So I put it out there.
That I'm eating healthy.
Something like that. Likely not true. But they've therefore made people who want to engage you to not need to physically interact with you to have that engagement. So that's the principle. So it's content that is relevant that people then track. If you want to therefore engage people, and that thing is called Odudua. But it is, my friend's got his food in there, you know, his picture of his grandson is in there, whatever. It's content that is close to my heart. I promise you I'm going to go there.
Okay.
So the name doesn't really matter. It's just I think it's best to recognize it for what it is. This technology is there. And what those guys are doing is they're putting communities together. Are we better off as a local community? Identified and been deliberate about it as China has done.
Yes.
Because China closed that wall.
Yeah.
Right?
They blocked it. Yeah,
so completely. You want to have stuff to do is WeChat. So WhatsApp is
irrelevant,
big though. Elsewhere, but it's not an issue in China. So they've been deliberate about it. So it is possible. So there is no law that says it has to be Facebook. Just for example, Twitter was banned and we moved on.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not like that's the end of the world. But other channels, if we can call them that, media owners and so on, need to know that there is a shift in the consumer behavior that tends towards that. So if you're a television station today, is your competitor the next TV station or is your competitor Netflix?
It definitely is a digital platform.
It's a digital platform.
Yeah.
So if that's the consumer behavior, the platform you are on right now, does it lend itself to that behavior? I.e. stacking, you know, a whole season, you know, together.
Yeah.
Which means I could watch it for an entire weekend, which means, you know, all of that.
Back to back. An omnibus of
all of that.
Yes.
So is what you have, if that consumer behavior has changed and you are not able to match, that doesn't really matter whether you're NTA2 or you're Channel 5 or it's that the consumer had moved from what you are doing. And unless you are able to compete in that kind of way, then that platform will be dominant. There are kids now who don't understand the concept of television.
Yeah.
Because why will I have to wait till 9 o'clock to watch the news? I can take it off the internet.
On demand.
Yes. I can, you know. So the digital natives, are going to be a difficult audience to address for the reason that they are used to managing information in a fragmented area. I grew up when information was wholesome. You kind of needed to go to a library to get a book.
True.
That library is available
everywhere
now.
Yeah.
So they don't even have to leave their house to have access to it. So that's how they review content. It comes to them. They don't have to go for it. So as you know, people who are in media, we always have to keep track of the trend.
Okay. I'm thinking about an aspect of advertising that hasn't exactly changed that much, even though it has evolved technology-wise. I'm talking about the billboards.
Okay.
The big billboards started out with wooden planks and people painting on them.
Absolutely.
Started out as, you know, getting artists to do a beautiful artwork, impression of something or some brand. Then eventually it became the stick-on, sticky version, then the tarpaulin, and now it's the LEDs. So I'm thinking billboards haven't really changed. I guess it's just the time of the day that you can consume them that has changed. Because at night you couldn't see the painted billboards.
Yeah.
Now the LEDs
it's better.
Exactly. I'm wondering around the world. I know this has already started in places like Times Square years and years ago. First of all, it took quite a long time for it to get to West Africa. I guess because of so many different factors. Electricity.
Cost being a major cost.
Maintenance and probably still is a big factor.
It is,
But then there are other things. The type of content that can be consumed on an LED. So what are the things that you and your company have had to put in place to make sure that your consumers are getting everything they need to?
So that's a very, very good journey you've traced of from hard work to where we are. But again, it's about shift. The shifts in marketing therefore automatically impacts the shifts that our medium allowed to go through. Basically is that at the time when the boards were pretty much static, it was location based, i.e. I'm in Suriname, right? There's this board there. So you could actually use it to describe where you're going, like right next to the Coca-Cola board and things like that. So it was iconic. And some part of, like, a part of the landscape, very important part of the landscape, part of how I knew roads as I traveled because of my work was that did I not go past that billboard that time? It was one of, like, a landmark thing for me.
Even in some parts of Nigeria now, on the roads.
They would describe it. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But as the audience trend changed, you now had a very mobile audience with lifestyle. And again, the way they consume content then also changed. They got served little things with time, so you could get
bite size.
Brilliant. You could get a 1 minute content on Instagram and all of that. And it became important to be able to serve that onto other kind of platforms, and digital naturally became a part of that trend. So now you now no longer have that location belonging to Coca-Cola. You have that location in the digital world belonging to so many audience that want to, so many clients rather that want to reach that audience. So we became less about the location and more about the audience. This road is often taken by people who are 18 to 35, middle social economic class, all that. So irrelevant to Coca-Cola, it's relevant to Pepsi, it's relevant to Indomie, it's relevant to. So why do they need to put something there that isn't dynamic? Instead, they can be a part of the content that is in the location that is good, that their audience will be impacted by. That's all they want, an audience count, rather than to own a structure. So if you want one structure, one location, and only 10 people go past it, those are the only people that are going to see it. But if you are in a place where a million people go past, even though you are just part of a dynamic stream, part of those million people will encounter you. So there's a greater chance of being impacted. And that's why you have had that shift. But what's also important is to recognize that it's actually, in my view, an engagement option. See, because we see it in a lot of how it's deployed in West Africa, as a more like on the roadside, big, impactful, and it is, no problem with that. But when you take it one scale below that and you think of digital screens on on like bus shelters and things like that, it starts becoming functional where it could be a map of the area.
Sure.
And you get lost, you get to the bus shelter, you press something, it shows you where you are, and now you could. So there is a lot of interactivity that it can provide. Admittedly, more difficult to do on the large format, but
based on cost.
Cost, and also you could argue, could it be distracting? It's a roadside.
I was actually going to mention that.
Yes.
In terms of the fact that you have some billboards placed in places where they could be considered traffic hazards.
Yeah.
But for some reason, there were permits that were signed for this particular billboard, or let's say LED board, to be placed there.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, this is not to knock on any doors or pinch any toes, but it does feel like in other countries around the world, there are some policies, that some limitations that have been put in place. In West Africa, can we say the same?
I think we'll need to get better at it. I don't doubt that. But with everything in life, you can improve. I think the first thing we should be grateful for is that West Africa has at least embraced it as a way forward, not like something to be thrown out. Next thing is now, are there better ways of doing it? And I'll be the first to admit that that is true. What is the major requirement, in my view, is an environmental impact assessment. And there are two levels to that. You just spoke about the visibility across the road.
Of course.
So there is regulation there, actually, pixels and things that is standardized, part of global practice. So it's not even just about Nigeria or even West Africa. But there is the other side about, mainly we use generators, and you have a lot of those screens out there. So as you have the screens, then you have more generators. And what do the generators contribute to
the environment?
Yeah. So that there is that broader issue about that, call it environmental impact assessment. Yeah. So we would need to find better ways to integrate it into society, make it a part of society. For example, part of what is now obvious is it can serve dynamic messaging, i.e. if there is a road closure, it can provide that information because it's to the minute.
Okay.
Think about it when it was static.
It's
you needed
live,
to go and print and the road will have cleared by the time you're there. So, you can do something that is immediate there. So it's got its uses.
Yeah.
So it's just to find the better ways
Thinking back to how my mom used to warn me about the rays, the radiation, she says. Now we're being guided on how to use our laptops, you know, because of the amount of light hitting us. And then you have these glorious LED billboards where you're in traffic, you're at a traffic light, and it's literally blaring into your eyes.
Yeah.
You're squinting. And so I understand how far we've come, but hopefully regulation will be enforced. So I know they might be in place, but enforcing them is another question altogether.
I agree with you. I think there is also the importance of the awareness for the public to be aware. Is there some hazard in this, or all of those things? My company is kind of like a leader in terms of what we feel is sustainability of technology. Just don't do it. Do it in a way that is sustainable, so that when it's not us that's running it, it's our children that are running it, then it actually can be useful to them. So we don't want to do it in a way that is just about today, that, you know, let's make money today and let's not bother about what tomorrow is. So there's a lot of studies, energy assessment. Nigeria is tough to apply global standards to because when I tell them about diesel, most times they don't even know what I'm talking about. But it is a part of our lives. So it's part of what we need to do now. But I'd rather start working towards when perhaps those screens will be powered by solar and all this. And that's the challenge that we need to give ourselves and say, look, nobody's going to come in and fix this country for us. We have to fix it for ourselves. So if we have to, then what are the skill sets we need that can start applying to that? So if we use a lot of generators and we know it's damaging the environment, so what's the, we can sit here and complain about it, or we could try and do something about it. So shouldn't our engineers start trying to find what the alternative and say, Look, here's an alternative. Try this on your board.
How efficient.
Always very, very willing to try. We've been trying new things because we want to measure up to that global standard and say like, oh, we don't use diesel anymore. Our energy consumption has gone to XYZ. Now we're a problem for the rest of the world, actually, given how much we rely on those diesels. But I can see that changing. When I started in the business, it wasn't what it is right now. So I'm optimist as to, so long as we target that there will be change in future, we tend to do it. Because at least the story I'm telling 21 years after is not the story of how I started. So I'm encouraged by the progress we've made.
True. Yeah. And I have to say, honestly, thank you so much for coming to share with us, you know, all this. I have to ask though, as a final note, or let's say maybe a final angle, audio podcasts are being said to be the future for audio. Like, for instance, radio, terrestrial radio is becoming gradually obsolete because there can be radio on demand. The same way we have TV on demand.
Yeah.
Now, we are, of course, a podcast platform.
Yeah.
And we have been able to begin in our journey. But where do you think we should go from here?
I try to do a lot of predictions and because of my journey. It's always turned out wrong, so I think I'm the wrong person to ask about predictions. I will give you a point of view.
Okay.
I'll give you a point of view. I'll give you an example of a concept I had in just 2008, which kind of doesn't seem like that long ago, which was about convergence, right?
Okay.
I had that thought that we were carrying too many devices at the time. iPhone I just launched. There was iPod. There was iPad. There were laptops. There were many. So screens were getting to be like a lot. And I thought, no, this is not sustainable. What's more than likely going to happen in future? And I still have that document today and I read it and I look like an idiot when I look at it. That what's going to happen in future is that these things will converge. What was my thinking of what convergence will be? Hardware.
Oh.
That we wouldn't have any device. We'll probably have one device that can do everything.
Okay.
Kind of has happened, but not in the way I thought. What I was missing out on then was something called cloud. So ultimately, what was convergence, or what still is convergence, has become possible because of a software
cloud
solution
software.
Rather than a hardware solution.
Mm.
So by having the cloud, then your information is stored, right? So it doesn't matter which device you are, your ecosystem can be deployed onto it. So it was a software solution rather than a hardware. And I've never forgotten that. So I'm always careful about my prediction. I think I can take the one about the broadcast to the broader issue of the platform wars, as it's now called. So you have the emergence of the Spotify's of this world and Apple Music and all of that, and how global they have become, where even though they're global, you can still customize and you can be a part. So that, so long as that is in play, and we've talked about a young dynamic audience in Africa that is more than likely eager to take as much information as they can from just about everywhere else. So I think that it's a question of relevance. That the radio stations as you have them now more than likely will evolve. The TV stations as we have them now will evolve. It's very clear. Platforms are the future. So whether it will be aggregated, whether it would exist as individual podcast and so on, but more than likely our access to audio will be via streaming. Rather than a tuning of a frequency.
Of course.
More than likely. So if that is the future, and the podcast and all that is a part of that ecosystem, so obviously, you're in the right business.
All right, then.
Maybe you're less challenged than I am because I'm in the business that has to do this movement from static to digital. And added to that is the method of buying will become programmatic, which is artificial intelligence, which means that you're thinking about use of less people. Even in all of
automated.
That.
Automated.
Automated in all of that. So there is a lot that is changing and is impacting all of us. But I, rather the optimist that I am, actually see that as a very positive thing, as a sign of progress, and also that it doesn't mean companies or brands or firms will go extinct. I think it would only challenge us to evolve. I think that's just it.
I have to say a huge thank you. I'm hugging you from over the table. Thank you so much for
I'm
coming.
I'm virtually accepting the hug.
We've been having a very interesting conversation with the country manager of JCDecaux Nigeria, the one and only Mr. Dele Odubemi, someone who's had an interesting journey, and we've been talking advertising strategy and, of course, the West African dynamic. Hopefully, we were able to, you know, plug some holes into some people's mindsets, because there is a lot that's happening. I think it's just about us jumping on board. So until next time, Mr. Dele, please, anytime you're in the neighborhood, please pop by once again.
Thanks for having me.
All right, then. Please stay right there. If you would like to reach out to us, you can always reach out via Instagram. That's at Africa Business Radio on Instagram, Facebook, and LinkedIn. And, of course, at Africa Biz Radio on Twitter. We appreciate all of you listening. Don't go anywhere.